Well, good evening.
Certainly glad you guys have joined us for Paul's lecture recital. You'll find some of this information just amazingly interesting. And we'll get started in just one moment. Before we do, if you have a cell phone, please pull it out. And let's turn them off so we don't make noise during his show, okay? That's always a good idea. And without further ado, let's welcome Paul.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming. I'm super mild. So this lecture recital is going to be on Charles Tomlinson Griffiths. This lecture is just as much an introduction to the song styles of Charles Tomlinson Griffiths as it is an observation of the development of his compositional style. Before March, I had never heard of Charles Tomlinson Griffiths. His song cycle, Three Poems of Healing Cloud, was introduced to me by my colleague, Thomas Kennedy. I immediately was struck by the beauty of his rich harmonies, its song and soaring melodies. I asked some of my professors if they had heard of this cycle, but none had. Few barely knew of Griffiths, and those who were familiar with him knew either of the White Peacock or his famous piano sonata. According to the Rose Encyclopedia, as well as other sources, Griffiths has been given the title First American Impressionist. There certainly are plenty of Impressionist traits in Three Poems of Healing Cloud, but his song cycle did not strike me as purely Impressionist. Upon further research, I found that Griffiths composed far more than just Impressionist music. Donna Anderson, the researcher who has provided more information on Griffiths than any other, states that to classify Griffiths exclusively as an Impressionist is to fail to understand fully the variety of his styles represented in his music and to disregard his individuality. Before discovering this fact, I found and pursued several varieties of music composed by Griffiths and received a variety of opinions regarding them from both professors and colleagues that gradually molded my own theory as to why he developed stylistically. A brief background on Griffiths. He was born in September 1884 in Elmira, New York. He was first and foremost a pianist, a prodigy. He began as a child and studied with Mary Selina Brousel, who realized his amazing talents. As he grew, he aspired to be a concert pianist, and Brousel financed his studies in Berlin at the Stern Conservatory, where he moved in 1903. Griffiths had always been interested in composition, and in 1905, he left the conservatory to pursue his studies in composition with a more progressive teacher named Humperdinck, who unfortunately was only able to give him about a dozen lessons. He continued to take piano lessons, teach, and compose Lieder, which means German song, until he returned to the United States in 1907. This time, the time that Griffiths spent studying in Germany was very influential to his compositional style. Of the songs that he wrote, all but a handful of them are either German or English. He wrote 26 songs in German, 35 in English, only two in French, which were the first two songs he ever wrote, three in Sudanese, and one in Japanese. He was fluent in German, French, and Italian. But despite knowing the language, he never had any interest in composing songs in the Italian language. Logic would also suggest that his compositional choices were influenced with his love of German and English literature. He had a vast library filled with biographies and letters from famous composers such as Wagner, Liszt, Richard Strauss, Schumann, Beethoven, Mendelssohn, Scriabin, and more. He also collected the poetry of Heine, Goethe, Eichendorff, Lanoue, Scott, Tagg, Hebel, Whitman, Keats, Sharp, MacLeod. He also had the complete works of Baudelaire, the complete works of Oscar Wilde, and of Edgar Allan Poe. His greatest German musical influences were Johannes Brahms and Richard Strauss. I am going to have Stephen play the accompaniment accompaniments to two lira. One is like Brahms, and one is like Rippus. See if you can tell any difference between them. Great deal of similarities between these two works. The first piece, the accompaniment that Stephen played, is Der Tod, das ist die kühle Nacht by Brahms. Death is like the cooling night. And the second is from the song cycle I was singing in a moment, Am Krause hier zu graben by Griffiths. At the crossroads they buried him. Which I said, as we just heard, Griffiths practically mirrors Brahms' rhythmic ostinatos, as well as uses a more of a folk-like melody, a technique that is common in Brahms' music. Griffiths' accompaniment, well, you'll hear the melody in just a moment when I sing it. Griffiths' accompaniment, just like Brahms's, also sits very low in the bass, creating a darker tone. A similarity that is not surprising considering that both songs speak of death. Griffiths even said that his earliest compositions, published by Schirmer in 1909 and 1910, were more the result of compositional study than his own musical expression. In which case, he was a very good student. This is not the only song in this German set with clear Brahmsian influence. More rhythmic ostinatos, as well as hymnodas, also a favorite tool of Brahms, will be heard in An den Wind, the second song, and another folk-like melody will be heard in Meerestimme, the third song in the set. As for the last song in the set, So halt ich endlich umfangen, it bears parallels to Richard Strauss. These are seen primarily in Griffiths' use of soaring lines, climbing phrases, chromaticism for dramatic effect, accelerandos, free use of seventh chords, fuller body harmonies, and by modulating subtly and often. All of these influences are seen in Griffiths' fourth German song, So hat sich endlich dich. But influences can also be heard from Strauss in his other songs, such as the chromatically rising phrases in both An den Wind and Meerestimme, and the chromatic bending of the phrase, such as the word ungeheuren, in der ungeheuren Weite, in the enormous distance. And now, the four German songs. Thank you. to Anderson, as well as other sources, Griffiths understood that a great song must be a balanced partnership between the voice and piano, and the text and music must serve each other. He also fully understood the capabilities and limitations of the human voice. There is no trace of awkward or clumsy vocal writing in his songs. She also states that Griffiths had a wonderful sensitivity to the blending of words and music. His rhythms and meters are perfectly tuned to the rhythm and meter of the text. I will give her the second statement. And I won't judge her, and I wouldn't judge her so harshly if she hadn't spoken in such absolutes in the first statement. But as far as her first statement goes, that last German song is a whole step shy of having a 2-octave range. And when it comes to following an A natural with a B natural shortly after, it is very, very taxing on the human voice. And my colleagues agree. Now, at the same time, I will give him some grace, because he did write that song in his 20s. And Lord knows I couldn't write like that in my 20s. I can't write like that now. But there is also a saying that there are people who have something to say, and there are people that have to say something. And if you apply this to pianists, you could say that there are pianists who have something to play, and there are pianists who have to play something. And far too often, you can ask my accompanist, Stephen Kennedy, far too often Griffiths is the latter, and Griffiths tends to fill the accompaniment very, very full. In fact, Clark Kennedy, the gentleman who runs the music program here at the church, when I asked him if he knew of Griffiths, he said, "Oh, I love Griffiths, but I don't play Griffiths," because Griffiths' music is incredibly difficult. And I understand, you know, that as you will hear, you know, there certainly are not at all like that. But it is not uncommon occurrence with his music, and I believe that the difficulty of the piano part and the vocal line is the primary reason why his music is not performed very often, particularly the difficulty of the piano part. Vocal lines, particularly in the four impressions, the next one is not nearly as difficult as the vocal lines in that last German song and in the Field in the Cloud songs that I'll be performing in the third set. But Griffiths, certainly his music matured as he got older, and you will hear those differences. He wrote all of those songs in his 20s, as I mentioned, and most of them while he was still in Germany. He returned to the United States in 1907, and in September became the director of the Hackney School of Music in Tarrytown, New York, just north of New York City, a position he held for the next 13 years. Some sources speak of him struggling financially, but he actually did quite well for himself as a professor there. It may not have provided the glories of some famous composers' lives, but with a modest salary, room and board, and a nice protected environment to compose leisurely during the summers, Griffiths was not only wanting, not to mention, he was only a stone's throw away from New York City, where he was able to advertise his music. In 1911, Griffiths made a rather sudden turn in his compositional style. He shifted from his dramatic stage to what is known as his impressionist stage, and composed much of his music that has earned him the title of first American impressionist. According to the Dictionary of American Classical Composers, Griffiths' song cycles, 3 poems, opus 9, and 4 impressions, which I will sing today, are ideal examples of his impressionist style. Despite their French titles, the songs in his 4 impressions are examples of his decision to write almost solely English texts after 1911. His 4 impressions also provide plenty of evidence of Debussy's influence. We are going to play this game again. I'm going to have Stephen play a piece from Debussy, and an accompaniment from Debussy, and also a piece from I was opportunity today by Griffiths. See you. The first was the beginning of WCS in Gold Cathedral, and the second was the opening of Le Réveillon, or Dawn, from Griffiths for Impressions. Now, some might accuse me of comparing apples to oranges, considering that Debussy's work was originally for orchestra or piano, and Griffiths is a song. But I want to remind you that this was the opening of the Griffiths work, and more importantly, that Griffiths was first and foremost a pianist, which is why I believe so many of his accompaniments are so very dense. Both of them resemble the early breaking of the dawn of the over the sea, and later portions of each work grow to the sun rising from the sea, and later portions of each work also use walking septuplets to envision the sun breaking through over the horizon, and in Griffith's case, fleshing through the branches of gold. Griffith strives to escape diatonic scales with the intermittent usage of modes, pentatonic scales, and whole tone scales. He also will cleverly disguise separate chords by moving through them chromatically, as in the words, "floats on the waves." In the last phrase of Lament, the C, a simple descending E-flat minor chord, is made far more complex and unique through the chromatic movement, through the addition of a C-flat and an A natural preceding and following B-flat. Ostinato figures, such as those throughout the impression of Du Matin, Early Morning in London, produce mysterious and suspended sensations, as well as provide unique symbolism. The alternating high and low block chords imitate the clanging bells of the Big Ben clock tower, growing louder and softer as the character is supposedly walking through the streets of London on a foggy morning. Symbolism is a common and very strong tool of Griffiths, and he can be observed in each song of his four impressions. Diminished seventh chords are common harmonic phrases, are often left unresolved, and unexpected harmonic progressions are used for the sake of expression. These sudden non-diatonic harmonic shifts are the greatest justification for Griffith's impressionist style. Debussy, the father of impressionism and the composer upon whose music all other impressionist music is measured, once said, "My desire is to reproduce what I hear, a subject where action is sacrificed for feeling." For Debussy, the listener's sensual response took precedence over all else and demanded freedom of form and immediacy of expression in the music. There is no form or rule followed by Griffiths in his four impressions or any other of his works during this period, for that matter. The songs can, however, be seen upon immediate listening. They often lack some of the most common that you see in impressionist traits, such as playing an unfelt rhythm, floating motifs, and a higher placed accompaniment. After a short listening, even my former theory professor felt that it was not true impressionist music. The song merely struck him as 20th century art song, at least the portion he got to hear. He was one of, uh, he was of the opinion that the music was more Strauss-like in nature. I had also felt that Griffith's composition was not purely impressionist, but then again, according to Gross, neither is Ravel. So where were the other stylistic influences? I, like my professor, felt that Griffith's German roots, particularly those of Strauss, were finding their way into his impressionist framework. That was until I found another quote from Griffith. He says, "When I went to Germany, I was of course ready to be swept under by the later Wagner and Richard Strauss. It is only logical, I suppose, that when I began to write, I wrote to the vein of Debussy and Stravinsky. Those particular wide interval dissonances are the natural medium of the composer who writes today's music." This also explains why he had the rather sudden shift in his style. I certainly believe there is evidence of early Stravinsky influence in Griff's four impressions, particularly of Stravinsky's compositions prior to 1920, known as his Russian period. Comparing Stravinsky's The Cloud from 1902, or even the nature of his Rite of Spring from 1913, to Griffith's La Mer, revised in 1916, there are unmistakable parallels in the rhythmic grit created by the dynamic rhythmic ostinatos, the harmonic coarseness created by wide intervallic dissonances, which coupled with dense textures, extensive vocal ranges, and large dynamic contrasts lean more towards Stravinsky than Debussy. The Encyclopedia of American Composers describes Griffith as one who was able to retain his musical identity while assimilating the best around him and stamping it with his own individuality. There is certainly evidence of this in his cycle for impressions.
The veil is with a chalice falls on.
only three of which I have been able to represent today. The fourth from the third from 1916 to 1917 was his exotic oriental phase during which he embraced his fascination with musical styles of Eastern Asia. He based all of his Opus 10 songs on 5- and 6-tone non-Western scales, avoiding thirds and emphasizing fourths and fifths. His most famous songs from that period are Five Songs of Ancient China and Japan, and his very popular tone poem, The Pleasure Dome of Kublai Khan. In late 1917, Griffiths began to shift into his fourth and final stage, what is known as his abstract period, during which he finally began to develop his own personal style. In 1918, Griffiths composed his song cycle, Three Poems of Field and McLeod, which, according to every credible source I have read, is the peak of Griffiths' achievements as an art song composer and his prime example and the prime example of his personal style. The poetry is very unique in that the poet, Fiona McLeod, is actually William Sharp. This pseudonym used by Sharp was kept a very, very good secret until 1905 when he passed away. In fact, Griffiths had written songs using the poetry of both Sharp and McLeod prior to 1905, not knowing that they were the same person. Sharp composed all of his music, Sharp composed all of his mystical and primitive Celtic poetry as McLeod, and the three Fiona McLeod poems chosen by Griffiths are no exception. In The Lament of Ian the Proud, an isolated old blind man reminisces about his love whom has passed. This brings in both joy and sorrow as the leaves that blow represent both his feeble body and heart. But he continues to persevere. Griffiths uses what is basically a Wagnerian leitmotif, using a theme at the beginning of his work to represent Ian's grief throughout the song. This theme consists of a triplet rising to a dotted half note three times, followed by a descending F minor chord. If you look on your examples, there's an example of this at the bottom of the second or the third page. Stephen will now play this for us, and the first four bars of Ian the Crown. This scene is reinforced as Griffiths adds rising triplets to the melody, and twice provides a three-measure break in the melody for piano to remind the listener of the original theme. Once before the B section, and just before the climax of the song. There is even dialogue between the voice and piano as the pianist answers my questions. Is it the old sorrow and the old grief? Or is it a new thing coming, a whirling leaf about the gray hair of me who am weary and blind? Each of these lines has a clear response from the piano during the final note of the phrase, each of which is held by the vocalist. We also see symbolism in the arpeggiated triplets played by the pianist throughout the work, which represents the wind that is blowing. Rising minor broken chords played in 16th notes also represent the whirling leaf being swept away at the end of the song. The form is through composed, but Griffiths has the theme return at the very end to create unity in the song. In Thy Dark Eyes to Mine, the second song, Griffiths holds true to his classic bronze influence and that he composes it in an ABA form, taken from an Irish folk ballad. The floating ostinato, which covers the first 10 bars of the song, provides a mystifying Debussy effect. The juxtaposition of the left and right hands in the piano part enhance this enchantment. This is appropriate considering the poetry is regarding the rapturous eyes of the poet's beloved Eileen. which, believe it or not, actually means island. Eyes so passionate they can draw the poet in against his will, referred to as fire and thus deemed supernatural by MacLeod's standards. The B section drops the ostinato pattern and turns to chromaticism in both the melody and harmony to express the poet's emotion. Great emphasis is put on the word leap. It is repeated 3 times in the poem, once in present tense and twice in the future tense. The first time the word is referring to the leaping to the fire in her eyes and is held for an entire measure and then repeated. Second time, the phrase is placed in a triplet pattern that gives the impression of lighthearted skipping or dancing. And thirdly, the phrase leap afar climbs to the climax of the song. The delicacy from the beginning of the song as well as symbolism of the final words of a falling star are reinforced by Griffiths quickly rising the piano line to the treble clef and playing only ostinato figure coupled with the high C to E flats, which resemble a twinkling star. Griffiths creates another leitmotif in his third song, The Rose of the Night. This motif, and you can see this on the very back page of your translations, this motif is heard at the very beginning of the song, just like the theme in Lament of Being the Proud. This theme consists of a pattern of 2 sextuplets, one descending 16th notes and the other of ascending 16th and 8th notes. This is played over top of the triplet ostinato figure, which tend to blur any harmonic function, and the tonal center fades from one key to the next and almost never establishes itself in any official tonic. Stephen, will you play that theme for us, please? This impressionist trait gives a sense of being suspended or lost in one's thoughts. The dark rose is the poet's lover, who once again has a mesmerizing fire of enchantment that is drawing him to her. Just as the theme does in the first song, this theme returns during the 3-measure break in the melody just prior to the climax of the song. When the poet tells his love the dark rose of imperishable fire to kiss him. The theme is then heard one last time just before the song's end. The piano line, The Rose of the Night, rarely doubles the vocal line. Griffith's counterpoint consists of a horizontal layering of rhythmic motifs and melodic phrases, rather than focusing on functional harmony and vertical sonorities. This results in a great deal of chromaticism and places the pianist in an equal position with the vocalist. However, Griffiths abandons this momentarily, such as in the line Deep Silence of the Night, when the pianist plays the locked C chords for 7 bars until he returns to the contrapuntal style, playing the rising and falling pattern to imitate the C's thunderous might. Multiple writers have described Griffiths' musical journey as his search for his own musical language or personal style. Creating an entirely new compositional formula became the ongoing theme with Griffiths, particularly in his composition since 1911. He developed a style that does not fail to remember Brahms' traditional forms and techniques, that uses the climbing and soaring lines of Strauss, the emotional harmonic shifts and scales of Debussy, the pentatonic scales of the Orient, and the counterpoint and dissonant harmonies of Stravinsky, plus more than that. All of this with Griffith's personal touch. This development is a primary reason why Griffith's style and his influences can be rather difficult to decipher. One of Griffith's reviewers described his tendencies well after one of his performances, saying, "He is no servile copyist. His score has piquancy and pungency, and it is one of the hopeful intimations for the future of American music." In layman's terms, he doesn't just copy other composers. His music is bold and tasteful, and it's a hopeful indication of where American music is headed. Sadly for Griffiths, it ended far too soon. He died of empyema in 1920 at the age of 35. He composed for a total of 13 years after returning to the United States. Considering the developments, he had just begun to make his own personal style and his ability to break away from the European shadow on American music. Many believers believe that Griffiths might become the most influential composer of his generation had he lived another 30 years. Considering all, he was just getting started.
Thank you.
coming this afternoon. I understand no Cinco de Mayo, everybody wants to go out and, you know, party hardy. But no, thank you all so much for coming, and it was nice to have an audience. So God bless, and have a wonderful afternoon.